करो
Different, I think it's a everything is changed, so yeah, it's I think so it's a restart, I guess.
definitely
Absolutely.
then, yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely. Thanks, Sunil, and thanks, Sunil, for the amazing session. Warm welcome again, Arjun. I think great to have you back at our summit, though virtually. I'm going to take a quick 2 minutes to introduce Arjun. Arjun is currently the Chief Business Officer and one of the founding members at M5. He's an IIT Roorkee alumnus with over 10 years of experience across sales, revenue, and growth. And he currently leads the strategic initiative, strategic business growth at M5. Prior to this, he was Senior Director of Growth and Sales for Myntra, and he's delivered a 50x business growth during his tenure over there. He's also worked with Amazon as a worldwide capacity planning analyst, and he's obviously been in the digital space for a while. And in 2017 is when M5 was started, and now it's one of the fastest growing health tech startups, and it's been amazing to see it sort of hyper growth that that M5 has had, and today has actually helped more than 6 lakh patients and has over 3,500 doctors that the platform is partnered with. And of course, it recently also one of the most rated, best rated platforms on the Play Store with a rating of 4.6. So I think M5 has done a lot. So warm welcome, Arjun, to you at the Digital Premier League.
Thanks a lot, Vikas. It's good to be a part of this again, and looking forward to share whatever I have a little bit to talk about. And yeah.
Perfect. Great. So, would you want to start off with the deck that you had, Arjun? And then we had a whole set of questions as well. However,
So,
you.
maybe I can do the deck like quickly. I think
Yeah.
it's about 10-15 minutes, might be shorter than that.
Perfect. Absolutely.
And then the way, or how, or we can just go with the questions. What do you want to do?
Yeah, we can start with the deck. I think, like you rightly said, we can start with the first 10 minutes over there, and then we have questions that we can get
Sure.
into.
Okay.
Perfect.
Just give me a second.
Absolutely, yes. Yeah, the deck's visible.
Cool. Yeah. So basically, obviously, when we started M5, we were looking at healthcare from a different point of view. A lot had been done on healthcare previously, which was done keeping in line how a lot of innovation on the caregiving side, as in a lot of technologies which help better diagnosing, or there were better equipments which came, which doctors were using for surgeries. From the consumer-facing side, healthcare delivery was pretty much same. Nothing had really changed, and the way people went about was same. They used to go to a hospital or a clinic and wait there. For smaller problems, it used to take half a day, and you end up coming back in case you have some tests and then review the reports with the doctor. So pretty much a service where you actually needed instantaneous access, because the moment you actually fall sick or you have a problem, you actually need more immediate access to a doctor, while the way the service was given in an appointment format, and a format where you ended up waiting most probably the next day, or kind of did it over a period of you kind of solved that problem with your own understanding or somebody's inputs first, and if it worsened, you went to a hospital. So yeah, so just keeping pretty much that in mind, just a second. Yeah, so basically what we saw is that fundamentally quality doctors are far and they are few. India is a country where for every close to 6,000 people, there's one specialist doctor. And the point is that branded and accredited doctors are even something which is even a rarity. Top cities like Bangalore, Delhi, Mumbai, though have a lot of this, but even here, the ratio at which the number of doctors to the patient is pretty bad. Cities like Mumbai, it's not that great. Cities like Bangalore, Hyderabad, Delhi is far better than some of the other top cities. A lot of the other thing is purely dependent. A lot of the care delivery is dependent on purely on the doctor's ability. It is not purely, there aren't many systems which a doctor has, and that's kind of been always the way it's been working. So there have always been cases of misses, and even smaller things which get missed, which in case of health can have could have potentially serious outcomes if not really addressed midway. And some of these things are just based on pure standardization. And our intent was to plug that. Fundamentally, if you also look at it for consumers, it was because access was bad. It was about self-medication. It was about waiting. And basically, India being a hub for diabetic, hypertensive patients, we are almost the sugar capital of the world. And there's no systematic way where people's health is being monitored. In a diabetic case, you don't really need to interact with your doctor that regularly, as in go and meet him in person, but there still needs an interaction model. And the typical standard model never really handled that. So from that perspective, what we thought is fundamentally in India, and India, as we all know, what mobile has done in India, and what we needed is mobile. And to bring in the standardization, we need an AI, which basically enabled how we can get a doctor for everyone in India, right? Every consumer has a doctor on his hand and he's access to a doctor. And that truly will be a solution which will work for India. That's truly an Indian solution. So keeping into that, I did speak about it. Even the other ways when telemedicine was done, the erstwhile telemedicine, it was basically about setting up small PHC centers, which had a lot of devices, and there was a doctor sitting somewhere else. So it still fundamentally never really augmented the capacity of a good doctor. It was still very difficult because it required all the kind of equipment and a lot of those technologies. It fundamentally still created for consumer, it didn't change anything. Rather than waiting in going to a Bombay, yes, he might get the access of some of those doctors sitting in Nasik over a telemedicine platform, but then still he had to go and wait into line to get into that PHC center. So the earlier typical telemedicine solutions were not really in line to what the scale at which how healthcare has to be delivered. Just to give a context, this whole world we know changed post-COVID. COVID kind of forced us to suddenly go home. It forced us to really, there was fear about movement. And the other biggest thing is the fact that hospitals in particular, hospitals have never been known to manage infectious and non-infectious patients separately. What I mean by that is, people go to hospitals for a cough cold and they also go for diabetes. Diabetes is not a contagious disease, while communicable disease, while on the other hand, a cough, cold, fever are communicable diseases. So when a COVID came, even hospitals fundamentally became hotspots. And that kind of caused a huge restriction for people. And this actually kind of gave a huge, has fundamentally changed the way for the whole online consultation, telemedicine world. And the government kind of quickly pulled around and the guidelines which were pending for the last 6-7 years pretty much came in 3 months. And I think that's kind of done. And just a quick graph, and I, even though this graph is about 5-6 months and the adoption is far more aggressive now, but the fact is it's just happening across the board. You just look at wherever there is a gap, and this is just what we have from MFine's perspective. But that's the point, that consumers are really accessing something like this because what they need is quality doctors, and wherever they are, the need was same, and everyone was in a lockdown or a limited movement situation. And a solution like this obviously has fast-tracked the adoption of something like this. So basically what I fundamentally spoke something about is it's basically based on having trusted and healthcare provider system. So our objective is to bring in all the top hospitals in India. We are looking to build a network over the next few years of close to about 7,000 odd hospitals in the country. We have close to now about 800 hospitals on our platform, and leverage such a strong network and build in an AI system, which kind of brings in standardization on how care is given. So every doctor has his own assistant, which is an AI assistant, which kind of helps him get consistency on how he diagnoses a patient. And basically on these pillars is how we went about it. And that's kind of helped us scale. And even when we saw rapid adoption during the COVID period, it has helped us scale in spite of higher scale and maintain our rating. And somewhere Vikas did mention about the fact that actually as an app, we ended up are now trending towards the top rated healthcare app with a App Store rating of 4.7 plus. So these are some things which are playing a big role, and that's how we have gone about it. So I'll actually go ahead. So when we looked about it, also typically all telemedicine solutions were always looked at something which is only to do with consultation. But the fact is healthcare is, and that was the big challenge for us specifically around COVID and somewhere around that, is where we were a little slower on the piece of setting up the diagnostic businesses and all. We had to really fast track that, because when you go and consult a doctor, about 30-40% people end up requiring a lab test. Now, how to augment that and enable that through a home collection? I think that those were some really big levers. And fundamentally, if when you look at about creating a healthcare ecosystem, you can't really solve just one part of the problem, which is, let's say, you can't just solve consultation. You for a consumer, you look at the suite, which is a consulting product, potentially medicines, labs, and everything. If you look at it, when we look at hospitals, when we go to that, we fundamentally see that a hospital is one place where I can see a doctor, I can buy medicines, I can get other care and everything. So we had to augment a similar capable solution, but that was virtually, which was available on a mobile app. And that was the key focus, and obviously leverage data and kind of created, and for chronic conditions where people are needing more regular care, right from diabetes to hypertensive, where you regularly need to monitor your health, kind of build solutions around that. So keeping in that, I think so the big intent is how do you keep on innovating, and you have to fundamentally think what's the biggest technology platform we had. So for us, the way is the one single source of truth and the most, you can say the most highly capable as well as the a high performance device which we had was the mobile phone. Everyone in India, a large portion of India does have a smartphone, and how do we leverage that? So the way we collect data from the consumer, which is in a health keyboard format, not just text, but more in structured format, helps us to create, run our AI programs on it, to run ML on it, and leveraging acoustics. So for something as basic as developing, people can record their coughs into the system, and the system analyzes their cough to understand whether the cough is caused by something in the lower part of the lungs or the upper. It's an upper congestion or a lower congestion, or just the fact that you can upload images, to the fact that we are almost close to launching SpO2 monitoring on the mobile phone using the camera. So basically leveraging the most advanced technology, which was mobile, and to kind of replace a lot of the point of care or vital monitoring devices, that was the key. And rest was obviously tying in the other parts on how we use the structured data to, in terms of creating better knowledge about, for the AI system to have the complete medical knowledge and be able to iterate and come with more standardized as well as higher accurate recommendations for the doctors. So keeping all of this in mode, the interesting part is we ended up handling, these are the kind of cases, right? When the situation changed, a person who had certain symptoms which showed him potentially having unstable angina and basically needed to be medicated. For such typical problems, people used to go to hospitals, but how we enabled this and kind of, and typically this care takes about 2 to 3 days in a typical hospital, because first level, you just get a primary care doctor and then you get a specialist. Now to have access of a specialist and pretty much give him that in 20 minutes, that was the beauty of it. And in a situation and this new world where we are sitting in a new world where interactions are limited and the importance of remote is even more, even though a vaccine might come back into the system, but I think so healthcare has taken a fundamental step change, and handling cases of this nature really showcases how the progress has been, where typically telemedicine was always considered as a place where people consult for cough, cold, fever, headache, is now suddenly becoming a place where people are looking for heart diseases, neurological diseases. Then on the other hand, recently on the dengue, when we see a lot of people in India, there's a cycle of dengue patients and how we really managed it, right from his regular testing to how his daily catch-ups with the doctor was, his vitals monitoring, and fundamentally avoiding something as basic as a hospitalization and reducing a hospitalization. So this over a period of 7 days actually kind of just showcased that how a quality access can be delivered even remotely. And that's pretty much kind of looking at how the change happens. And a similar example, obviously, and which we see is that in India, obviously, and in the current scope, there are mothers and they are always looking at the best care and they need care 24/7. So how we handle cases like of an expecting mother who's in her final trimester, tracking her vitals to giving her, and obviously she still had to travel for her scans, but everything which was other than scans was handled remotely. So basically enabling this end to end has been the key. And obviously with the wave, what COVID has done is forced people to kind of adopt. And from a digital side, it was the biggest challenge for us has been to how quickly take the solution to more and more people and kind of continue deliver the product at that same level of accuracy and capability. Because on the digital side, as we saw the scale was increasing, it was very important to have a robust product. So on the consultation side, we had the AI systems, our triaging systems were pretty robust, and that's kind of helped us scale. While on the other hand, I think so, we went through a big cycle in terms of the lab testing and at-home lab sample collection piece. And I think so, those are places which shows the opportunity, something like how healthcare has changed. And fundamentally, it's changed that how primary care, which we expect over the next 3 to 4 years, where today majority primary care is dependent on these small clinics, will move fundamentally to a platform like us and other similar platforms. And secondary care access also changing a big role, where somebody sitting in Nashik doesn't need to really travel all the way to Mumbai to meet the doctor. His first, second, third opinions can happen remotely, and only he travels in case of a surgery or in case of something else. So these are some fundamental movements which has happened in healthcare, and we are kind of moving around this. So that was just, I just wanted to give a broader picture, because obviously health is a little different industry to most of the other typical retail industries. So yeah, Vikas, so I think so. I just kept it short and just had a short view on this.
No, absolutely. Thanks. I think it kind of covers a wide variety of activities that MFine is doing. So I'll probably kickstart the questions. And if there are questions in the audience, feel free to add them. I already see a few out there. So I think, you know, you spoke a bit about COVID and how it accelerated many aspects, right? And I think we'd love to understand what does that look like in terms of actual volume of patients and all of that. And also the other side of the coin, which we understand, is that even doctors are now more receptive to spend time doing the consultations, right? Which was probably not the case before. I think more than the patients, the doctor availability was a challenge. So maybe share a bit about how has COVID changed some of those dynamics as well?
Yeah, so I think so. The biggest change the COVID from the respect of COVID came was the fact that I think so the government just went ahead and set up the guidelines. Anything yes. Once the government sets up guidelines, I think so the reception of it either from the provider, which is like doctors and hospitals, or from the consumer, which is patients, both is it just changes the curve at which the adoption happens. So that was the key thing. I think the government just laying out, the Prime Minister going ahead and in his couple of sessions talking about mobile pay doctors se baat kare, things like that, it just changes the way how people perceive. Yes, in the interim, a lot of doctors, because obviously the need in India was way vaster, quickly moved to solutions which are WhatsApp calling and video calls on WhatsApp, and or even just simple audio
call. Yeah.
But on the other hand, what we realize is those solutions fundamentally don't work. They have their own inabilities, and also on the other hand, they aren't actually as per the guidelines, because they don't capture data in a certain way. It is not as per what is recommended. So I think so there was a wave of obviously just which the government announcement kind of made it both for the providers to just look for solutions which they can use around this. And the next wave is after the adoption is the sustenance of it. Obviously, like with any mindset, I think so all businesses went through a cycle and pretty everyone was hacking their way. So they ended up using solutions which were obviously not foolproof, which were not really thorough, or which were not something which were meant for scaling. So that's where I think so, where solutions like ours, there are solutions what Practo has built and other companies are building. Medibuddy, there are many companies who are doing this. Pretty Correct. Much, I think that's when all these companies went through a higher growth of cycle for themselves. But I think so, this growth is further going to be continuous, because where the initial a lot of movement went directly to the, the non-solution-based channels like WhatsApp and stuff like that. But I think so, they aren't really able to sustain. So we are now seeing how some of the large hospitals who ended up starting something with Skype calls, Zoom calls in the beginning are now fundamentally moving, because how data gets captured, how a consumer interacts, how does his follow-up happen? So that whole piece is a different product in itself. And I think so, that's a continuing movement, and we are seeing that piece happening now.
Sure, that engine is still not built at that end. Yeah, makes sense. I think there was a question actually here on that, right? That there are hospitals trying to build their own solutions as well. And I think some of the larger ones also have their own app ecosystem, medical records, all of that. How is that playing out with you partnering with the hospitals at one end, and at the other end, they're also competing with you in some ways on some services?
I think so. I'll give the easier way example. It is the way Amazon and a Myntra go against a Nike and a Vivo store, right? A Vivo sells phones on its own website. They also sell it in their stores, but they also sell it on Amazon and Myntra and a Nike same way, right? It's just that what a large curated marketplace can do, and it's all about traffic. And obviously the kind of experience of online buying you have on a Flipkart, Amazon is not the same of what you get on Nike.com, and the level of business tracking, recommendations, as in, I'm talking from the retail side, the same side, right? The evolution of the product, which we have in terms of the assistant for the doctor, how that piece works, how the ease is for the consumer to do a video consult, how his data gets captured, how is it stored, how he can track it. So I think so it's pretty much that it's eventually will come down to a larger product. Plus healthcare also is not only limited to one, which is again like retail. It's not that you're just bound to one particular. So you might be bound to a certain set of physicians, but for gynecology, it will be someone else. And typically healthcare is a family problem. It's not a very individual decision. So it's usually typically in a family, it's a husband and a wife, potentially elder parents, young kids. Right. There are multiple specialties, multiple needs, and one hospital usually is not able to cater that need. So there are multiple tenants of that. Then on the other hand, there is, like I said, healthcare is just not doctor access. There are things around labs, there's things around medicine. So I think so all that plays a role. Yes, everyone will do like, it's been done in the retail, but I think so eventually it comes down to experience and the width of services, which every platform will be able to do.
Sure, absolutely. And one of the things that M-Find did differently was also to go after the larger hospitals, the more famous physicians and the famous doctors, right? How did that approach come about? And now I think you have about 550 hospitals that you've tied up with. So you are also getting the best of best to kind of really consult with the patients, right? Yeah, which is very different than the others.
Yeah, so from our day one, the way we look at it is we wanted to build a solution which was primarily of higher quality. The point was telemedicine was always looked as something which is inferior. It was looked at you can just get some doctor, it not might be some doctor who's just an MBBS, not even a specialist, or it's a doctor who is not even in your vicinity. I am sitting in Bangalore and I'm consulting a doctor who is sitting in Srinagar. It's not that the doctor in Srinagar is bad, but most probably the context, what kind of medicines are, see, the medicines which are available in south of India are different to the medicines which are available in north of India. So there are a lot of those contexts which was lacking, and that's why telemedicine never flew. From our day one objective was to really say that this is actually better than really going offline. And on the other hand, we never said that we never wanted to reduce people walking into the hospital. What we said, this is the primary mode to connect. And if there are requirements, like even today, about 10 to 15% of the cases, the doctor ends up recommending you to come and visit him. So in that case, go and meet the doctor. But the point is, in 90%, it's not needed. So when it is not needed, why to delay that access from where you can get it in 1 hour to delay it to 1.5 days? So that's the larger point. And the position to the hospitals was, like any retail store, their business is built on the fact, large hospitals are built on the fact that they can handle patients, and they are actually higher quality centers with more focus on inpatient.
Correct. Yeah.
So when they build up a hospital, it's a real estate business. So everything has a catchment area of 10 kilometers, little larger hospital, 20 kilometers, 30 kilometers. That's the way. The moment they come on a solution, which is cloud, there it opens up, right? For a primary care solution, I sitting in Powai, I'm okay even talking to one of the top doctors who stays in South Bombay, because if my problem is very severe, I will not mind the 1 hour travel from Powai to South Bombay for a surgery or anything. That's not a problem. Because like I said, that's only 10% or even less than 10% of the problems. So I think that was the big change, that for large hospitals, we really opened up what they can do. So really taking the best, the doctors with the most higher pedigree, the top specialists actually, and giving access to more people to specialists. So if you have a neurological problem, it's better to talk to a neurology specialist rather than speaking to a general physician always. So that was the intent. And I think that that's what we've seen play out well also. From the hospitals, they were excited about them increasing their footprint from that perspective.
Sure. And how have you seen the entire preventive healthcare sort of shape up, right? And I think there are multiple angles here. One is obviously the corporate tie-up angle, where companies are trying to do things for their employees and team members. The other is obviously the home checkups that has obviously picked up. But are you seeing a lot more preventive health checks, or is that still yet to pick up in the context of COVID?
So I think so. What we are seeing is still more of lab tests. But the point is, when you evaluate yourself, so in India, 35-40% of the people have some of the other long-term disease, which could be from diabetes to thyroid to hypertension, all these chronic disease, some of the other chronic disease patients are suffering from. And for each of them, they need to regularly monitor. So when they monitor, it's not only one parameter they want to monitor. So they end up monitoring multiple parameters, and that's why this goes in the prevention zone. Also, with this business has further got a boost with the whole corona piece, because obviously people are more concerned about understanding where are they. There's one very interesting data, and this has been the year with the lowest number of cases on fever and dengue in India. A city like Bangalore, which is flooded with dengue cases from the months of late July to almost September end and early October, has hardly seen dengue cases. Obviously, it's driven by the fact that people have less traveled and gone out less, and whatever mosquitoes, and even in case of viral, it has reduced because of lesser interaction. But I just think people have also been much more focused in maintaining their health. And I think so.
Health and well-being.
Lot of wellness, like Ayurvedic medicines, and lot of vitamin supplement companies have seen big movement in numbers because of consumption of these drugs, which is vitamin drugs or other Ayurvedic immunity based drugs, right? So I think so. There's a movement, people with more focus on understanding what their current health is, and prevention seems to be something which people are slowly picking up.
Absolutely. There are two questions here which seem related, which would be good to take. Is one was on the legislation side of how teleconsultation, and whether how does it protect the patients and their data, right? And the data security of users. How's that playing out?
Yeah, so the government, I think, so launched a bunch of guidelines there. Actually, this Independence Day, the Prime Minister also talked about launching a universal health record ID. Now, that is something which will be out in the next 6 to 8 months. Which will get launched, but what it will basically do is, all of us, like the way we have an Aadhaar ID, we'll have a health ID. And what it will do is, all our health data will be mandatorily go there. So now suddenly, where all our health data was actually on pieces of paper, and many times hospitals might have better data than us, I think so that side will change. Everything will come to the consumer. The consumer will have the access, whom to share it with, whom not to share with it. So that's the view what the government is building on the data side of it. So the health ID is going to be a big thing, which is going to become a uniform thing. So even if you walk into a Fortis, or you come to an M-Fine, or you go to a Cloud9 hospital in person, the health ID will be same for you.
Nice.
and that will connect. So this is something which is an initiative has started. In terms of legislation, yes, the government gave out a bunch of legislation who can practice. For the first time in India, teleconsultation is now part as a course in MBBS and in postgrad. So now there is a fundamental change that doctors are going through a course. There's a new launch of courses where all doctors have been taken through this course. It's like a online course for about 2.5-3 months. We actually created that course along with the with Niti Aayog on this. So we played a very active role in creating the material for that. And we spent in that hours of building that content around it. So I think a lot of stuff has happened on that. And I think these are fundamental movements which have happened. And yes, I think so. At the scale of a country like ours, it still takes time. But I think so. These were things which were pending for the last decade or so. And I think so. Expecting over the next couple of years, we'll be at least 10 years ahead of where originally we were supposed to be.
So lots of wheels are moving in at the same time to make this happen. Absolutely. Moving a bit towards the marketing and the brand side, right? And you've recently also got on Sonu Sood as ambassador. What was the role there of getting an ambassador to scale this up, and how do you see that panning out?
Yeah, so for us, I think so. Obviously, we are a small young startup, still entering, still just scraping the surfaces of healthcare, right? The healthcare is a massive domain. It's just the scale of it and the depth of it is just too huge. While on the other hand, the need was obviously to take it aggressively to consumers because customers were looking for this. In India, on an average, every day, 8 million people were consulting a doctor. You can imagine when a complete national lockdown happened, that number went to as low as 10% of that. So there were so many people who were devoid of a service. So that fundamentally brought the need of a service like ours. And we had to aggressively take it out. Obviously, on one side, it required more capital in terms of investing money, marketing money. And yes, I think so. As any startup, there's only a rate at which you will be able to invest. But on the other hand, beyond a point for us, the big question was, we also need a voice to take our message. It's not that M-Fine is still young, right? We've recently, now today when we become a top-rated healthcare app, it's it's a feather which we can leverage to communicate to consumers that this is what we stand for. But it's still nascent days. We are still building our trust. Our networks, like I said, is still today Bangalore, Hyderabad, Delhi, Mumbai, and Pune. We are still nowhere near in networks in cities like Kolkata, Chennai, or the other tier two cities, the other next 35, 40 cities. So from that perspective, how do we build trust? And that's why we picked up somebody like Sonu Sood, who was just had a wave of, he's just done a lot of great work and assisted people. And he was quite excited about what we were doing. And that's how we picked somebody like him. Just to give more, healthcare is all about trust. I think so. Beyond a point, I can tell you can consult for free, but you will only consult if you, one, really need it, or secondly, trust it. Yes, then the price thing can come. Yes, if you are cheaper, I can most probably go there. But really, it's not a price game. It's really about the need of it and the trust on it. And somebody like him, we thought, brings in that leverage.
Credibility.
Adds that credibility for the brand.
No, absolutely. Like you rightly said, he also has a lot of work that he's done in this space. And it sort of gels in very well with what M-Fine is doing. That's great. The other thing I think M-Fine has really done well is also focus on giving valuable content to users, right? Be it through, I think you started off by giving content around medicines and then a lot of different guides on the website. And now I think the YouTube channel is also scaling up. I think that's something we haven't seen too many healthcare companies actually do in India. And so where is that focus coming from? And are you seeing some benefits from that content driving consumption and usage for the app as well?
So the primary, the way we look at it is when actually a doctor interacts with a patient, many a times he ends up giving a lot of generic advice about diet, about things, and there's a lot of explanation which happens. Now, this is done by some doctors, it's done very well. And by some doctor, it might be not done too well. It's obviously, this comes as a very personal trait, right? If somebody is a good, he speaks well, he communicates well, he interacts with people well, there's just a lot of content. So we thought our primary intent is there is just immense in terms of consumer knowledge, not like in-depth medical understanding about it. Yes, that is also important, but more about the consumer side of it. for a woman who's suffering from PCOD, what kind of diet she maintains and stuff like that. How she goes about planning her exercise routine, and how does she go about recovering from it? So and managing her lifestyle better around it. So that's how we started looking, creating content. And what we've gone in terms of, we are trying to scale, is we're trying to leverage our network of doctors. The doctors are there and they are kind of creating this, we call it the pill content. These are short, a minute, minute and a half, like a very pill kind of a short content. And we are kind of embedding it, one, openly for people, but also kind of embedding it as part of the consumer's prescriptions over time. So when you consult for a certain needs kit, you will see the relevant content which is attached. So you can quickly check if your orthopedic guy has prescribed you certain exercises, those content films will be there. So you, one, he explained you how to do it, but just to make it easy for you, because end of the day, we have a smart prescription. So the prescription, if it's just showing data, it will not be smart.
Correct.
It has to do more than what the paper and pen couldn't do. So those are things which we are working and building on, making the prescription more interactive and tracking consumers. So one, on one hand, it obviously adds a lot of value to the consumer. Plus also, it is also a huge marketing. Like we have seen, if some of this becomes useful, a lot of people, people know ways of downloading things from everywhere, and people know ways to share it on WhatsApp. And I think so. That's the core intent. If it can, health is a big referral market, typically.
Yes.
It's based on word of mouth, what I trust, and what I tell to people in my circle of 25 people. So building content is very key to that. And we are now focusing a bit more on that. And over the next year or so, I think so, we want to really see a significant movement in terms of content creation, attaching, even leveraging creators who can create for us, and working around it. A lot of creators are doctors themselves. There are a lot of doctors who are very famous creators. So leveraging them to create interesting content pieces, and bringing more new age. So rather than creating a basic content around what a diabetic guy should eat, we are trying to create it in a more marketing way, where you kind of show a dabba of a diabetic guy, open it one by one, show the ingredients. So kind of add a wrapper, which kind of makes it more consumer friendly and makes it more receptible to the consumer, rather than, because it is health, it doesn't necessarily need to be boring. It doesn't need to be just on a piece of paper written with like a long blog or lines. I think so. That's where we are trying to leverage video. I think so. Anyways, with all content platforms, video is anyway showing higher adoption.
Absolutely. Makes a lot of sense. And what's next for Mpoint, right? What's the next few things that you're working on that we could look forward to?
I think the next few things is, I think so. One is just taking it to the next 10 cities. So we are making a concentrated effort to scale it much more in terms of both the network, as well as from a consumer perspective on the marketing side, to invest in cities like Mumbai, Pune, Kolkata, Chennai, Jaipur, the next. So over the next 6 months, we want to go cover pretty much the top 10 cities in the country. And then from there, pick up the next 30. And that's one key focus. The other key focus is to really keep on developing technology and replacing a lot of vital monitoring systems, which typically people have devices, right? From a blood pressure meter to a pulse oximeter to
right.
a thermometer, and how we change everything. How can we leverage the powerful device which we have in our hands called mobile? Right. There is enough and more which is happening there. I think so, that's the key. The other things is insurance is another big piece which will kind of start playing a big role, because again, for the insurance world, telemedicine was always like that additional add-on which was just given because it looked nice. But now suddenly it plays a big role, because the insurance guy is one person who should know first about the person whom he covers, that he's potentially going for a surgery. But usually he ends up knowing about the surgery less than 48 hours.
Right.
So he has no fallback. He knows, okay, he is going for a surgery. So how does insurance start playing a role for preventive health? How insurance starts in aiming? So I think telemedicine has a bigger role to play there. Insurers are getting excited about it, right? From Aditya Birla to HDFC Ergo to Cholamandalam and all other insurance players. So I think that's a big lever which we see. And I think so in the next year and a half, I think so there's going to be significant movements there. That's also a market which moves a bit slowly. Obviously, they are more traditional in nature, but again, COVID has kind of thrown everyone to adopt things. And I think so, relook it from a new point of view.
No, absolutely. Makes a lot of sense. And I think the insurance companies probably have have it in their best interest to make sure the people recover, right? So that the insurance paid out is there. So
best is people recover without getting through a surgery. And for a consumer, it's best to not go through a surgery and get it recovered. So it's a win-win for everyone, I think. So it's just that there are no systems of really bringing that thing applicable, making that
perfect. David has a very interesting question, and his question is around, you know, because medical is a high concern, high involvement, vertical, how do you give the reassurance to the patient that, especially when you go into a hospital, go into a clinic, you go there and you know you're going to be taken care of. How do you bring in that reassurance through that teleconsultation? And are there things that you're doing to make that more seamless on the app?
Yeah, so I think so. One of the biggest levers, I think so, which was a primary focus from day one, is we thought that even though this is a solution which we are building remotely, it is a solution where you can access from anywhere. But we from day one, our focus was it has to be a local solution. A person sitting in Bangalore has to consult a doctor from Bangalore. Yes, he might decide to go and consult a doctor from Delhi only if he has researched or he has context about it. My ability to trust, if I stay in, let's say in Bombay, if I stay in South Bombay, my ability to trust a hospital which exists in South Bombay is way higher than any hospital, even how good it might be in Pune. I think so that's the clear objective. I think with that objective, I think so the network plays. So we are not a hyper-local business, but definitely a very solid local business. It is very important that network, and that is the big trust lever. Which at least we have tried to work from day one, is that enabling more local care delivery. Also the fact, the other trust part is comes from, again, an extension of that. When a consumer sees it's the same hospital which is around the corner, and the fact he understands this is only stage one. If needed, he can walk up to the hospital. So this both kind of accentuates. The other part is obviously we have queues where we kind of mandate, the doctors are mandated. We ensure that they spend a certain amount of time with the customer. A video call gets done in a certain site of scenario. An audio call 100% gets done. How much time gets spent? How the follow-up happens? The fact that you send a query on MFine and the response comes in under 60 seconds is the key to it. Between we work from 6 a.m. in the morning to 2 a.m. in the night right now. We'll live in next couple of months. We plan to take it 24/7. But even in those hours, our response is 98% under 60 seconds. So the fact to deliver that, I think so that's where it in for a consumer, it shows a lot of trust. And obviously, I think so consumers themselves rating the overall service, I think so that's a key part. And we have seen that piece also plays a big role. The other part is also from a marketing standpoint, we leverage is the corporates and institutions a lot. Like most of the other businesses, which traditionally are not promoted, but are not introduced to their folks or their customers by institutions, healthcare services are. So a corporate company will never say that you should go and buy a Vivo phone or an Apple phone. They won't really have an opinion on that. But they do talk about, because they actually do the employee insurance. So that's another route that if you can, from a marketing standpoint, you can leverage. So those are ways which we leverage in terms of also driving brand saliency and more trust for us. The other question you had was on, I forgot the second part. I think so.
That was the question. I think, how do you make that happen? And I think in many ways, like you said, when you're able to give a doctor in 60 seconds, that's even faster than, you know, finding something online or looking at a video and understanding the problem, right? It's like getting a direct personalized consultation in 60 seconds. It probably even changes behavior over time, right? Instead of going and finding the solution online, you probably want to, you know, get it through the app and speak to a doctor directly. So fascinating. The industry that you're in, which is, you know, health tech and telemedicine, has many funded players, right? So how is MFind looking at the next 5-10 years with so many funded players having the legs to kind of move forward and do different things. What do you think different? What is the one thing that you think differentiates MFind from the rest?
So I think so. Fundamentally, I think so. Healthcare is one business which has enough money to be made if done right. At a business model wise, the unit economics are pretty sorted. So our intent from pretty much is that, yes, obviously you have to raise money at some extent. But on the other hand, I think so. It's not, we see, and we are seeing certain cities, certain pockets, which are becoming fundamentally the business is how it is unit economic positive and how it can even turn EBITDA positive very soon, right? So the intent is not really to think the money has to be invested for growth, but on the other hand, the fundamentals of the business are pretty strong. It's not a business which is so driven on price. So if you crack the overall product and the need state, I think so that kind of gives us more comfort that it's not one of those fields where you need insane amount of fundraising to just support or build that nature. Yes, it will still require fundraising to build adoption because it's still a very new category. I still think it is 2011-12 of e-commerce. It's still those days of what Flipkart was in 2010-11 in India. It's health is still there yet, but the point is it's going to go through that same kind of a curve, but I think so with just stronger commercial financials in terms. So that kind of makes it less dependent on pure the amount of money which you'll need to drive that growth.
Perfect. I think it's been fascinating, Arjun. Any closing thoughts in terms of what brands and companies out there need to do to kind of continue hyperscaling, and any closing thoughts from your side on that?
Yeah, so I think so from a hyperscaling, I think so the big question in the new scenario has come down to marketing. I think so the clutter on digital has gone to a different level. I think so yes. The initial part of the whole lockdown piece, obviously businesses were shut, but now businesses are evolving. But what has also done is the limitations have, I think so innovation on digital is going to be key because I think so like I said that healthcare has kind of taken a couple of months, leapfrogged, I think so 4-5 years and kind of gone quickly on that cycle. But I think so the same would have been marketers' adoption to digital. The fact that the traditional, there are bigger questions on readability of newspapers, radios, and more standard. I think so just the fact that digital from a marketing perspective has become more key. And I think it's just there's more competition because end of the day from a consumer's mind space and from his view time, yes, it would have partially increased, but there's far more competition for that slot. So innovation is going to be big play. And I think so most marketers, I think so are fundamentally looking at where is it going to come from? I think so what is the next platform or what is the next smart creative or next way of reaching out to consumers? That's going to be key. And
No, absolutely. Thanks, Arjun. I think we look forward to innovating together to make that happen, like you said, and scaling. And it's been great working with you. Thanks so much for spending time with us and sharing part of that MFind journey and wishing MFind the best of success. And thanks for joining us today.
Thanks a lot, Vikas.
It's a pleasure working with you, Arjun, in terms of pushing innovation as well. MFind has been a leader in terms of setting the benchmarks for healthcare, in terms of quality as well. I think that shows across in all the thought process, even in terms of the website and the UX. It's really great working with you as well.
Great. Thanks a lot, Sunil. It was nice joining the session. And hopefully look forward to meeting you guys sometime soon.
Absolutely.
In person.
Thank you so much.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. Have a great evening ahead.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. For the participants, please do leave in your feedback for the session. And thanks for joining us for the entire day for the Digital Premier League. And hope to see you all of you tomorrow at 11 a.m. as we continue the sessions as well.
Bye, Arjun. Thanks again.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone.